It's way too early for you to be that quiet. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Amen. It's so good to have you in worship this morning. Thank you so much for being a part of our worship celebration. If you're watching online this morning, thank you so much. And also, we're going to do something a little bit different today because I will not be in the pulpit next week, and I'm kind of jealous about doing the communion service. We're going to be celebrating communion on the last Sunday instead of the first Sunday, all right? So, but if you're watching at home, I want to encourage you now, number one, go get your Bible, but two, go grab some juice and a cracker and celebrate communion with us. And also, don't forget that if you would want to have communion in your home, myself or one of the deacons or deaconesses would just love to be a part of that with you. Congregation, so good to see you this morning. We're going to, in just a moment, I'm going to say ready, set, go. And I want you to find someone you've not said hello to yet and say hello. But here's the rule. You can't walk from one side of the building to the other, all right? Takes me too long to get you back. So let's very quickly but lovingly find someone and greet them in the Lord. Let's stand together. Phil, you do the song, then I'll get up. I'm sorry, I screwed up. Hey, if you start singing, will they go back to their seats or not?
Walking
I taught the boy everything he knows, but not everything I know, so I still have a little bit on him, all right? Phil, thank you so much. Linda, if you're watching, we miss you, and we love you, and as you can see, Phil's got everything covered. Hope you enjoy your last week of vacation for a long, long time. So good to have each and every one of you here this morning. If you're a guest here with us this morning, or you have a unique prayer request or special prayer request, fill that out and drop it in the offering plate in just a few moments. We want to know who you are and how we can pray for you and just kind of just love on you if you'll give us that opportunity. It is so good to have each and every one of you. I do want to highlight a couple of very quick announcements, and then we're going to dive right back into worship. One is on my notes here say June 19th. That's already passed. It's September 19th. There's going to be a voter education seminar here in the chapel. Now, I was asked this morning already about that. Pastor, you going to tell us how to vote? No one's telling you how to do anything, all right? I've been pastoring long enough. I know that you, if I say do left, you're going to go right. But here is what we want you to understand, everything on the ballot, all the initiatives, what a yes vote means and what a no vote means. We are so blessed to have some very, very educated and legal scholars in the church. Past Mayor Boyd Dunn will be with us, and he'll be speaking that evening. And then also the past president of the state legislature, Steve Yarborough, will be. They've divided the initiatives up, and they just want us to understand what they mean, what a yes vote means and what a no vote means. And you'll be hearing a lot. And I'm going to ask you to do me a personal favor and pray about the initiative that goes too far. I'm not going to say much about it, but I am asking, as your pastor, we're in 100 days of prayer for our election. And please pray about the initiative on abortion. It's a very radical, radical initiative. And I just pray that godly minds will prevail there. And then also, starting Friday on the 20th, every Friday and Monday at 1:30, we're going to be reteaching biblical citizenship. If you were a part of that, we packed out the room over in the conference room at the office. And that just, it helps us understand the foundation of our country and how much scripture played into that. Don't forget this Thursday, we have the ball game, the Diamondbacks game. Pick up your tickets from Tracy in the back. And if you, where? Oh, at the sound booth, at the very end of the worship service, grab your tickets at the sound booth. And if you need transportation, make sure you let her know that as well, okay? Ushers and greeters, please sign up. Let us know when you're going to be here, especially for the next 2 months, so we can get all that underway and make sure we have all of our bases covered. Phil sang that song about crowns, and you know, the Bible promises the believer, the child of God, in multiple passages, there are five crowns that we are promised that God himself is going to give us. Five crowns. Today we're going to talk about one. But we will receive, if you're here today, and you know that you know that you know that you know that you know, you've given your heart and your life to Jesus Christ, there is a treasure stored up for you in heaven. And as we worship today, we're going to pray towards that end, that if you're here and you don't know Christ as your Savior, you will take seriously the claims that he has on your life. And if you know Christ, we will live worthy of that crown we're going to receive. Let's bow our heads, our hearts. Holy God, we come before you in the name of Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, asking that you would just move in our midst, God. Thank you for what you have already been doing. Thank you in advance for what you're going to continue to do. Through your written word, through the spoken word, through the praises that come out of our mouth, would you receive honor and glory and praise? Would we yield our hearts and our souls to you today, God? Be with those that couldn't be here with us today, Father. I lift up Faye to you and I pray for her. I lift up Steve and Mary Lee. Father, so many others. Pray that your hand would be upon them. You would watch, provide, and care for those that can't be here today. Lord, we love you. And we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
church that was divided and confused, and they loved to argue a lot. They had divisions within the church. And Paul, when he wrote that church, he said, listen, I want us to come together, but I want us to come together for the right reasons. When you come together, I want you to come together in unity and in love. And then he said this, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant. It's in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it, and do it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. I'm going to ask that our men that are helping me with the Lord's Supper today would come forward. That right there, during the meal, the Sabbath meal, for the Passover, there were four drinks taken. This was the fourth cup, the cup of redemption is what it's known as. I was at dinner a couple of years ago with some friends, and we were having this conversation, and one of the guys said, he was older than me, and he said, you know, I've never understood the picture of the cup of redemption. And I said, think of it this way. It's our opportunity to toast God, to literally say, thank you, God. Thank you for this new covenant. Thank you for this new plan in your life. You gave your blood to purchase me. Guys, I'm going to ask you to come forward. I'm going to ask during the next few moments that you would just prepare your hearts. If there's any unconfessed sin, confess that. Give it to the Lord. And then allow us to serve you this representation of what it means to celebrate a broken body and spilt blood.
Thank you.
yesterday, I had the privilege, and I mean that. I usually Butch prepares the elements for communion, but Butch is out of town, and I love coming in to that empty room and filling these cups and praying over them because of what it represents. Don't forget, and I was asked yesterday, Pastor, please remind folks that there are two cups in their hand, that the wafer's on the bottom cup. So I'm reminding you now, so you know. I'm going to ask that Dennis would lead us in a word of prayer, and then I'm going to ask that as the body in unity, we consume all.
Raise my Savior, oh, what day long. Our scripture reading today is Titus 1 and 2. Very short, but there's a lot there. So let's listen and see what Paul is asking or telling Titus to have the church do. Remind them, that's the church, to be submissive to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, and to avoid quarreling, be gentle, and show perfect courtesy to all people. That's a whole week's worth of work. Let's bow our head in prayer. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for the freedom of worship that we have. We ask you to guide us in our daily lives to help us be very aware that things we do, the way we speak, the way we treat others, and our attitude has an influence on all those around us. May that influence be positive in showing others your wonderful love. May we live in our daily lives so that others can see you through the things that we do and the way we live. Lord, there are many members of the congregation who can't be here, would love to be here, but they're not well. We ask you'll bless them, encourage them. Those that are mourning, we ask you'll give them peace. And may we always remember the other person. In closing, I'm going to read the words of the song. We love you, Lord. And we lift our voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Amen. Thank you.
City called glory.
Wickenburg, Arizona, I think, when this took place. Little tiny country church. And he had not planned on singing that song. And he told me before that evening's worship, he said, "Hey, Mitch, I'm going to sing I Bowed on My Knees." He said, "I just kind of feel like that's what God's leading me to do." And I said, "Just get up there and tear it up." The church wasn't real full. But sitting on the, and just had two rows of pews, but sitting on my right-hand side, about three rows back, were a mother and father and about a four-year-old little boy. And Phil started singing, and it's kind of hard to calm him down at times. And the more he sang, the more energy in the room came. And the little boy stood up, and Mama jerks him down and sets him back down, and he stood up again, and he's just celebrating Jesus and with all of his little four-year-old body could do. And the second time she set him down, he got to that verse, "I clapped my hands and sang holy," and the little guy ran to the other end of the pew and just started jumping and clapping. Oh, that we would have the ability every once in a while, to be 4 years old again and to celebrate God with that type of enthusiasm. In the 27th chapter of the book of Matthew, we see that Jesus has gone through trial, and the 27th chapter and about the 27th verse, in fact, it is the 27th verse, says that they had brought him out and they put a scarlet robe on Jesus. And they placed a crown of thorns on his head. It says they put a reed in his hands. And then they backed up mocking him, bowing down, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews! Hail, King of the Jews!" And right after that, or shortly after that, probably after the blood had coagulated with the wool robe, just as maybe a little bit of the sting, a little bit from the scourging that had taken place had stopped, they ripped the robe off him again. They led him to the cross. They nailed his hands and his feet to the cross, with that crown still, according to what we believe at least, with that crown still on his head. He gave his life
for us. He sacrificed his life for us. That crown he wore late last week, I wanted to understand it better. And I began doing some word searches.
And that word cross in Matthew 27, the Greek word is stephanos. And it, now imagine, it's a crown of thorns, okay? It's got spikes in it, and they've shoved it down into his head. Not gently, but they push that crown of thorns on the head of Jesus. That crown, stephanos, means mark of royalty. Literally, that's what it means in the Greek, and you chase it all the way into the Latin, and even now today, when we think of crown, we think of royalty.
A mark of royal or exalted rank. The wreath or garland, which is given as a prize to the victorious. I don't know about you, but when I get that picture in my head, I'm not much of a prize to get. But it was such a prize. Because he literally had fulfilled everything the Father had called him to do. And he received a crown. But he wore a crown of thorns so we can wear a crown. Think about that for a second. My Savior wore a crown of thorns so I can wear a crown. 5 times in the Bible, crowns are mentioned. We don't have time to go through all of them. I do want to go through probably one of the most beautiful ones, and they're all great, and they're all very important. But in James, the first chapter in the 12th verse, it says this. Remember, we're talking about the purpose of trials. James chapter 1 is talking about withstanding and living through trials. Living through trials. There are some of you in this room that know what that means. Mary, it's so good to have you in service this morning. And last Sunday afternoon, you right about this time, you were saying goodbye to your husband, weren't you? Now he's with Jesus. I was with two families yesterday. One, celebrating the anniversary of the loss of a loved one. The other, preparing to go be with the Lord. Trials are a part of our life. And the way we live and the way we act during those trials is very important. I appreciate Dale's prayer this morning. People are watching. And they're watching to see what our attitude and our lifestyle is going to be like, even in the midst of a trial or a hardship. James, in the first chapter, in the 12th verse, says, "Blessed is the man who perseveres under enduring trials. For once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him." It's a beautiful picture, the crown of life. James tells us that those that remain faithful amid the trials, that those that remain faithful and don't give up, we are promised a crown. And you know what's interesting is I thought, I wonder if that's the same word. You know, in the Greek, they've got multiple words for the same English word we have, and they have multiple meanings. And so surely, if they put a crown of thorns on Jesus' head, if he's going to give me something good, he's not going to give me a crown of thorns. Guess what? Same crown. Stephanos. It's a badge of honor. It's something to be awarded to those, according to James, that have the ability to hang in there when the hanging gets tough. They receive a crown. but it's the crown of life. Crown of life, the Greek word for that is zoa. And what zoa means is, it's really interesting. It doesn't mean that I'm just drawing air. You with me? I'm just drawing air. That's not what that means. Well, my brother, right before he died, was in intensive care. He wasn't thinking. He wasn't responding. He wasn't doing anything. He was alive according to the machine, but in his soul, I would try to awaken him. I would try to get him to respond to me, and I couldn't get him to respond to me. So he was alive, but it wasn't the kind of life that probably is being mentioned there. In the book of John, chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus said, "I have come that they might have life and have it abundantly, full, explosive, filled with purpose, filled with meaning, a life that just is, you cannot stop it almost, a life that makes sense." I shared with you yesterday, or shared with you earlier this morning, that yesterday I was in the room back here in the back, and I had laid out the trays and put the cups in the tray. And again, we use two cups, the bread in one, put another cup in, put the juice in the other. And I'm back there, and praise God, no one was in the room, because I'm singing and praising God, and I would not want anybody to have to suffer through that, that's for sure. But I'm just carrying on, and I'm looking, and because I haven't done it in quite a while, I've got everything in order. Okay, what's next? And we have this cool little device, and you fill it with juice, and then you go over each cup, and you just kind of punch it, and it just shoots out the right amount of juice. As cool as could be. I was so excited about getting to use that new little tool that I had not used before, that I skipped a step in the process. I filled all the cups with the crackers, and I forgot to put the other cup in. And I'm about 3/4 of the way full filling these cups. Now I stop for a second, and I'm thinking, maybe I'm brilliant. Maybe I just killed two birds with one stone. You don't have to separate them. You just kind of drink and chew at the same time, and everything's good. And needless to say, I didn't do that, because there would have been ramifications from some of our elders, I promise. But as we go through life, we're going to make mistakes. Key is, can we laugh at our own mistakes at times? Can we figure out a way to back up just a hair and say, okay, that wasn't the smartest thing I've ever done. Maybe I should do this a little bit differently and see if the outcome's not a little better. So sure enough, I went back, refilled cups, made sure cups were in all of them. Some of you may have got 2 or 3 cups. I don't know. Jesus said, "I've come that they might have life and have it abundantly." But he also said this: the thief comes to kill, to steal, and destroy. The thief. Our spiritual battle is real, y'all. And don't ever think that you're not under attack, Christian, because you are. There are always going to be those times that we're under attack, and the evil one, or the circumstances that we're in, want to steal and kill and destroy any joy, any purpose, any fulfillment that could come from that trial or could come from that moment. But notice what Jesus says: if you love me, I've got a crown for you. And it's the crown of life, Zoa, and it's a life that's full, that's vibrant, that is filled with anticipation each and every day when you get up. Yesterday, I spent 2 very unique hours with Steve Seawalt, and we were preparing his funeral, working on his funeral for 2 hours.
And we're wrapping everything up. We're getting done. And I said, Steve, I wish you'd just get mad. And he said, do what? And I said, I wish just for a minute you would get mad at chemo or get mad at radiation or get mad at somebody. For goodness sake, Steve, God's big enough. Get mad at God if you want. And he said, you know, I didn't think I'd ever have to give the preacher counseling. He said, let me tell you something, Mitch. Every morning when I wake up, I can get up on the right or the wrong side of the bed. I choose the right side. And then he went on and he said this. Do me a favor, don't feel sorry for me. I've got it made. I have it made. Because here's what I know. That I'm living in paradise here with my bride and my home. And before too long, I'm going to open my eyes and I'm going to be with Jesus. That's John 10:10 life, by the way. You see, because the thief could sneak in and steal his joy and steal his purpose and steal his hope. It could happen. And it does happen from time to time in people's lives. But as I was driving home yesterday, I was ashamed of myself and I had to have a conversation with God. God, I'm sorry that I'm not living that John 10:10 life that is filled with anticipation of what you want to do in my tomorrows. Someday, because when I was a little boy at 8 years old, I gave my heart to Jesus Christ. I didn't understand necessarily what it meant. I didn't understand all the ramifications of it. But I did know that I needed to give my heart to Christ. And he came into my life that day. And he's walked with me each and every, not just day, not just moment, each and every second of my life since that moment. Through the good and through the bad. When I was making sense, and when I had no sense. He was there the whole time. Loving. Providing. Caring for me. And he's made a promise to me. That soon this old body's going to give up. Soon. Maybe tomorrow, well, let's not pray that happens during surgery, all right? I don't want anybody praying that way. Tomorrow or 1,000 tomorrows from now, I'm going to close my eyes to this earthly body, and I'm going to open them in the presence of the Lord. And he's going to say, Mitch, I wore a crown of thorns, so you can wear the crown of life, eternal life. Have you looked over your life today? Can you put your finger on a time that you made that same decision that one 8-year-old little knucklehead made and said, Jesus, I'm not all I need to be, but I know you love me just the same. I invite you into my life. Lord knows I didn't become perfect. But I became different. I became a child of God. You've never done that before. Before you leave here today, see me, see Pastor Phil, see one of the elders of the church. Let us tell you what it means. Let us tell you what it feels like to have a relationship, not a religion, but a relationship with a living God. Because I believe with all my heart that soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. Amen? Soon and very soon, we're going to see Him.
going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
You okay?
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King.
Forward. I don't know if this bad or not.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Dennis is walking down the aisle, and I didn't know he was going to do this. He'd come up here, and I'm thinking to myself, man, one of the senior elders of the church is getting saved today. What in the world?
Finally.
Revival has broken out. How'd you go?
Now, anybody who'd like to come up here, we're going to pray over the pastor before he leaves and heads out for his surgery tomorrow. So if you want to join us, please come on up. We're just going to gather around him and give him a good blessing and ask for his well-being and healing quickly and all of that before it happens tomorrow.
Really? What a blessing.
Come gather around somewhere. Can't reach Pastor Mitch, just grab him to somebody else. Okay. Heavenly Father, we're gathered here today, and we just thank you for this time together. We ask for the best for Pastor Mitch on Monday, that you would guide the surgeon's hands. Continue to be with all of them that are involved, the nurses, the doctors, and we just ask for a good outcome, rapid healing, and a minimal amount of pain.
Yes, Lord.
And we just thank you for what you're about to do, and we just love you and praise you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you all so much. Appreciate this more than you'll ever know. I got a call yesterday from my surgeon, and he said, are you nervous? And I said, should I be? And he said, I would be if I were you, but let's pray. Gotta love the guy. You just gotta love him. God bless you all. Again, if you're a guest here with us this morning, we meet next door for coffee and cookies and all kinds of stuff. Go and be a part of that tomorrow morning, 9:30 prayer time. You don't want to miss that as well. Thank you for being here. God bless you. You're dismissed. Hey, Jimmy, front row. Thank you. I know you.